Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is May 6, 2018. This is the sixth Sunday of Easter. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte. The choir director is Vicki Perks. St. John's has a food pantry open on Wednesdays from 9 to 10:45. They have a rainbow table every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone is welcome for a meal. St. John's will be set up at the Clark County Fair. The last full week in July will be in the Mercantile Building in the same booth that we've occupied for the last 4 years.
Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Pastor Pollock will be doing the readings.
A reading from Acts. While Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they invited him to stay for several days. A word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So, Sing a new song to the Lord who has done marvelous things, whose right hand and holy arm have won the victory.
Watch the yard.
sale, the garage sale, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and for all those who helped tear down, pack up, and return the gym to its normal state. All of your help and support, thanks to those of you who purchased items and attended, all of you, we thank you, and your participation is greatly appreciated. The next three Sundays in May are all special. First of all, next Sunday, of course, is Mother's Day. Here at St. John's, we still celebrate Mother's Day. I know it's popular with some churches, especially liturgical churches, to not celebrate Mother's Day anymore, but we still celebrate it here, so next Sunday will be Mother's Day. The following Sunday, May 20th, is Pentecost, the birthday of the church, the third great festival of the church year. As usual, I ask that you wear red in honor of the birthday of the church. That is the color of the day, red. So May 20th is Red Sunday as we celebrate the birthday of the church. Then the last Sunday of the month, May 27th, of course, is Memorial Day weekend. And that means the 8 o'clock service, which is to the Melody Driving, out on Route 40 for our summer driving church. So next week, Wednesday, then Pentecost, the birthday of the church, then the opening of our driving church for the summer. Now I ask that you give your attention to the poll.
Thank you.
grows here.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In our gospel lesson for today, we continue with that 15th chapter of the Gospel of John that began last week. As we hear these words of Jesus, we need to be reminded that these are what are known as the last discourses of Jesus, for these are words that he says to his disciples in the upper room the night of his betrayal. From chapters 13 through 17, Jesus is basically giving his disciples the last instructions before he undergoes his betrayal, his crucifixion, death, resurrection, and then during those 40 days of his resurrection appearances, he gives them some more teachings, and then he ascends into heaven. But like any person who is facing death, we cling to the last words they tell us. And so it means that chapters 13 and 17 through 17 are very important to us as followers of Jesus Christ. Last week we heard Jesus say, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." He is the vine, we are the branches. He is the source of our spiritual nourishment and sustenance. And what is most important in what he says, in those final words, "apart from me, you can do nothing." And that is something the church sometimes forgets. We try to do things on our own instead of relying on Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. We are faced with a problem and we try to come up with secular influence solutions to that problem instead of going in fervent prayer to Jesus and the Holy Spirit, who promises us that they will give us the strength we need to face those problems. For apart from me, that means to be separated from, to be without him. You can do nothing. That means not a thing. Not a thing. No. So when we try to run the church or do ministry in the church or fix a problem within the church without Jesus, we're barking up the wrong tree, and we're wasting our time. We have to rely on Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. So Jesus tells us we are the branches off of him, as he is the vine. We are nourished by him, with him we can do all things. And then in today's reading, as we pick up with verse 9, Jesus specifies further what he means by bearing fruit. So we focus on verses 9 and 10. And we read, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love." So what is Jesus saying? First of all, the word "abide" means to remain in something or with something. It means to dwell in them. It means to endure with it. So just as the imagery of a branch has to stay on to a vine in order to remain healthy, we continue to abide, remain, to dwell, to endure with Jesus each and every day of our life as an individual Christian and as a community of faith. We have to abide, and we cannot go off to something else. And how do we abide? We abide in his love. Now this is where the church sometimes runs into problems. Because in our language, we only have one little four-letter word for love. And we use it all kinds of ways. We use it to really mean use it when we really mean we strongly like someone, or we favor someone. We say we love our spouse. We say we love our parents, our grandparents, our children, our aunts and uncles, our best friends. But at the same time, we say we love a certain kind of food. We love a certain kind of dessert. We love Springfield donuts. We love ice cream. We love coconut cream pie. We love coconut cake. We love Mr. Good Bars. And then we turn around and we talk about how we love a certain type of clothes or a certain material. Or we love a certain type of hairstyle. Or we love a certain perfume our wife wears or a certain lipstick. We use that word love to say we even love a certain college or professional ball team or both. Or we say, like, I would say, I love the Derby. And I never miss it. Because that's part of my culture and how I brought up, was brought up. But we don't really mean love in those sense. We just mean we have strong feelings for them. We really like them. And especially when we use it toward inanimate things. You know, some people love diamonds. They love gold. They love rubies or emeralds or some kind of jewelry. That's an inanimate object. How can you love it? It can't go back. It's just a thing. But that's how we use the word. And so when Jesus says, abide in my love, being English speaking, we don't really have received the full impact of what it means. Well, the Greeks were lucky. And extended, they had several words for love. It all was a matter of what they, the point they were trying to make. First word was eros. The Greek word from which we derive our English word erotic. It's never found in Scripture. Because it means simply sexual attraction or lust. Really, it's more lustful attraction. Then they had the word philia. That's the word for love, which basically describes, in its truest form, love for spouse, parents, grandparents, brothers and sisters, children, aunts and uncles, cousins, that kind of thing. Filial is the basis of Philadelphia, the city in Pennsylvania, means city of brotherly love. That's basically part of the basis of filial, what it means. Well, that's not what Jesus is saying. He's not saying eros. He's not saying philia. It's a special word. A word that we find in the New Testament only and in the Old Testament translated in Greek, only in describing the love of God towards us. It means an unselfish love which seeks and to meet the needs of another. In its most basic form, that's what the word means. An unselfish love which seeks to meet the need of another. It also has a meaning of compassion, or to be compassionate. But not compassion towards those we already love. Not compassion towards those who are friends. Not compassion to those who have the same political or social views we have. It means compassion towards those whom we don't like. Those whom we find disgusting. Those whom we are at odds with. And it even means compassion towards our enemies. It means to seek to meet their needs. When it comes to an enemy, the idea is if you do something that your enemy needs, you will win them over as a friend. As I mentioned before, the easiest way to understand what this means, agapeo, is the word that's used here for agape, which is more familiar to you probably, is John 3:16. For God so loved the world, he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. See, the situation was, here we were living on earth, and we thought thought we were pretty cool. We thought, yeah, we know God, you're up there, but we got a great mind, and we know how what we want, and we know what we need to do, and we know what we want to do, and you just stay up there in heaven, and we'll take care of things here on earth. And we see what a disaster that's been. So God knew we needed help. We didn't know we needed help, but God knew we needed help. And it begins with Abraham. Faith. God comes to Abraham when he's 100 years old or so. Tells him to pack up and move from where he's lived forever. Go to the strange land he's never probably heard of. Has no idea where it is. And tells him, once you arrive there, you and your wife, who's way beyond childbearing years, you're all going to have a son. And that son is going to be the child of promise. And from that son is going to come a great nation. A nation so numerous that it's more than the stars in the sky or the sand of the seashore. And Abraham went on faith. He didn't argue with God. He didn't tell God to find somebody else. He left on faith. And then we had the Hebrew children in bondage in Egypt. And God sends Moses to deliver them from that bondage. And he leads them toward that promised land that had been that new home where Abraham had moved to. And he made a covenant with them that he would be their God. And he would, they would be his people. His chosen. But it meant not that God just loved them and didn't care about anybody else. It meant that he was choosing them to be a light to the nations of the world. That they would show the Gentile world who God really was and how God wanted people to live in relationship toward him and one another. But as the years progressed, the Hebrew children began to think that chosen meant just them. And that Gentiles were dogs and not worth salvation. And they kept God's covenant to themselves. And they began to make all kinds of rules and laws and traditions around the original laws, supposedly to protect it. So that their religion became not based on faith like Abraham's, not based on faith like Moses and the children in Mount Sinai. It became a religion simply of fulfilling laws and regulations, right? A religion of work. So here we were still in that sinful state. Here we were still separated from God. But God looked down on us and his love for us, his compassion was so great, even though we were disobedient, even though we were violating all of his laws. Out of that love, he sent his only son, Jesus Christ, into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. He willingly went to that cross and offered us his blood, a sacrifice in payment for the sins that we commit, so that we might have forgiveness and salvation. That is what this word love means when he says you abide in my love. It's not affection. It's not something that's in return for something we're given. It is this compassion that God had for us because he doesn't want us to be condemned. He wants us to be with him. He wants to have a relationship with us. But he wants it to be based on our willingly doing it and not being dragged, kicking, and screaming into the kingdom of heaven. So we have that choice to accept or reject. But that does not take away the fact that God has his love. Jesus has his love for us that is so great that we're willing to do anything to end the war between us, to end the disobedience, to reconcile back with us so that we could have this relationship that lasts for all eternity. So that's what Jesus means when he says, abide in my love. And then he says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. That word keep means to preserve something, to observe it by doing it. Basically, obedience. Obedience to Jesus Christ. Obedience to God's will. It means to guard for loss. The military term. gardens and important paths to keep the enemy from coming through. Our soldiers on guard duty at night to prevent the enemy from sneaking up on them. Means we guard the words of Jesus, the commands of Jesus, so that they are not diluted, they're not changed just because society changes. That means remain steadfast to that word, to His word. It means to keep an eye upon. We keep our eyes upon Jesus. The writer to the Hebrew, letter to the Hebrews tells us that. Keep our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. That is where we focus. Because of this love God and Jesus Christ have for us. It also means to hold fast. In other words, we don't flee the word of Jesus just because somebody's put pressure on us to do so. It means we don't turn our back on the words of Jesus just because society doesn't want to hear it. It doesn't mean we turn our backs on the words of Jesus just because it's not popular anymore. But instead we hold fast to His truth. So this love is what we're aiming at. This love that is not selfish, not self-centered, but it is love like God. Love someone enough to be willing to meet their needs, to submerge your will or their will, so that there may be peace and harmony. So abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. Love and the results of love are the evidence of our union with the Lord and of our sharing the life of the true Bible, Jesus Christ. Obeying Jesus' commandments is evidence of the genuineness of our love. What were those commands Jesus gave us? To love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our mind. And the second one, like it, to love our neighbor as ourself. And then in that 13th chapter of the Gospel of John, after Jesus had washed the disciples' feet, and after He had instituted the Lord's Supper, He said, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. That same love, word, agape, agape. It's not filial. It's definitely not eros. It's agape. We, toward each other, are to have that love of God, that love of Jesus Christ, that is unselfish and seeks to meet the needs of others. That is the way the community of faith is to be. But when Jesus talks about love, it's not some airy idea, some warm feeling, some ineffectual wish. It is a conduct and a behavior in daily life. It is putting into action the words we confess. It means seeking opportunities to help others, being sensitive to their desires, and to help them in their need, and to be a companion when they have no one else. Compassion. Being compassionate to those who are different. Being compassionate to those unlike ourselves. To open up the church and the love of Jesus to every person. No matter race, creed, color, origin, ethnic group, economic status, education, or lack thereof, no matter their neighborhood, no matter whatever we use to discriminate against people, all of those are not to be present in the church and in the community faith. And that is how we show that we are attached to the vine and that we are bearing fruit. But love also can mean intervention. Remember, it says to seek to fulfill the needs of someone. Sometimes somebody needs intervention. Unfortunately, during the latter part of the 20th century and into the beginning of this 21st century, some churches took this attitude, well, Jesus is love, and Jesus loves everyone, and Jesus never turned away anybody, and everything is fine. It's not exactly accurate. Remember when the rich young man came up to Jesus, and he asked him, what must I do to have eternal life? And Jesus said, you know the commandments. And the young man said, oh, Lord, I've done those all my life. Jesus said, there's one more thing you must do. Sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and come and follow me. What happened? The evangelists tell us the young man dropped his head in sorrow, and he turned around and left because he was very rich. He didn't want to give up his possession. And the next thing we read is Jesus says, it is easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus didn't run after that man and say, well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to make the condition so rough. I didn't realize we have so much money and be a burden. You come follow me and you keep all your wealth. No, that guy made the decision that he didn't want to take up his cross and follow Jesus. So it doesn't mean everything we do is okay. Sometimes, as a church or as an individual of the church, we have to intervene in somebody's life when they are doing something that is harmful. We can't just simply use the excuse, what Jesus is love and loves them, right? And sit there and watch a family member destroy their life with drugs. Or to sit back and say, Jesus is love and loves everybody and everything, and watch a family member destroy themselves with alcohol. Or destroy themselves with some other kind of addiction. Or some other kind of passion or hobby or something that threatens their life. We have to be proactive. We intervene not out of legalistic anger, we act out of intervening love. Because we see the person has a need, and our love being unselfish, we want to help them make the most of their life, not the least of their life. It's the same thing intervening into the life of a young child who doesn't have support at home for their education and volunteer to be a tutor with them. I can remember one of the most rewarding things that I did in college was I was a big brother to a 13-year-old kid from the inner city of Lexington. That young man went on to play basketball for Lexington Henry Clay and earned a college scholarship at Murray State. Played basketball for Murray State. So I was his big brother for the 4 years I was in college, for 3 years that I was in Lexington. And that's intervening. That's not maybe as dramatic as intervening somebody with a drug addict or an alcoholic, but that's still intervening out of love, showing that love of Christ, showing that love of God, and passion for someone who has a need. That is what Jesus is calling us to do. And then he tells us that by doing it, there's a promise. In verse 11, these things I have spoken to you that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. See a promise? My joy. Jesus had joy even in his passion, his crucifixion, his death. Of course, in the joy of his resurrection and ascension. Jesus gives us, as St. Paul describes it, that peace which passeth all understanding. And we have millions of Christian martyrs who have witnessed to that peace which passeth all understanding, to that joy that they have, even in the face of trial, tragedy, and tribulation. The word joy literally means a calmness, to have a delight or a gladness, even in a difficult situation, because of your faith in Jesus Christ, because you are part of the body that nourishes you and nurtures you. Too often we see joy or happiness in ourselves or in the things we like to do, and that joy is just temporary. Usually joy in our human experience is stimulated by something outside of us. By food, by a friend, by an experience of some kind. That gives us joy, but then that joy disappears. The joy of celebrating a birthday, anniversary, or the joy that Gene and I experienced last week seeing Jackie take her first communion and celebrating Katie's 13th birthday. Well, that was kind of sad, realizing, you know, first grandchild was now a teenager. You know, she keeps getting older, but we don't. That's what I told her. But, you know, still that joy is temporary. The joy that Jesus gives us lasts forever. But we have to rely on Him. As He said last week, without me, you can't do nothing. But with Him, we can do many wonderful things. Joy is a byproduct of a life lived in the works and love of selfless generosity. That is where we find that joy. Living that life of Jesus, being that little Christ into our need. So the nitty-gritty of love is not anybody does anything or anybody believes anything. The nitty-gritty of love is having that love of God, that agape love, that unselfish love. Relying on Jesus and the Holy Spirit to act out that kind of love brings us that true joy. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Ask now that you turn to page 6 in your bulletin, as with the whole church, we confess our faith with the words of the passing.
Eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day He rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and His Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you promised to hear our prayers for the sake of your Son. Help us to accept your invitation to ask you for all good things with boldness and confidence. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, we live in a world plagued by sinful doubt and skepticism over your word and salvation. By your Holy Spirit, open our hearts this day to pay attention to what you proclaim to us. Seek our doubting conscience with a certain knowledge that your gospel promises are true. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creator of heaven and earth, abide with all homeless and destitute people. Despite their temporary problems, give them faith to confess that you richly and daily provide everything they need to support their bodies and lives. Stir up generosity in our hearts as we respond to your mercy by sharing your good gifts with those in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord of the nations, bring order where there is instability, peace where there is strife, and safety where there is danger. Especially protect those who live and serve in dangerous areas of our cities. Give wisdom to those who place an authority over these locations as they deal with violence and danger. We residents and authorities, make our neighborhoods safe and lead everyone to work together to promote peace and tranquility. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Eternal God, through your servant John, you gave us a vision of the life of the world to come. By this heavenly vision, sustain those who suffer in any way. Use John's testimony to strengthen their faith, that despite their current affliction, they may look forward to the glory that will be revealed to them on the last day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Father in heaven, we yearn for the day when the holy city of Jerusalem will come down out of heaven, the day when you will fully dwell in the midst of your people. Until that day arrives, strengthen our faith in your wondrous promises as you dwell in our midst in an unbreaded wine, the body and blood of your Son. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And your hand, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Our ushers, Linda and Nelson Smith, are collecting the offering now.
Care and prepare us now a feast on the bread of life. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. We believe his body, blood, and truly present as we have in his table. In our communion age and own individual congregation, we are invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with the Great Thanksgiving on page 7 in your book.
The Lord be with you.
given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. The 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 body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you.
By our Lord Jesus Christ, and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in true faith and the life eternal. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who receive the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. We conclude our celebration with shouting again at the river in number 423 in the back of your red hymn book. In number 423, shall we gather at the river.
Concludes our 10:30 service for the 6th of May. Next Sunday is Mother's Day. Food pantry is on Wednesday, 9 to 10:45. Rainbow table is Friday, noon to 1 o'clock. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.